So when Amy was doing her thing, when Amy kind of retired at that time, Moet won over Amy, and that was it. That's kind of how that happened. And Moet was doing her thing, and she was voguing. And then Moet walked the ball against Delilah, and that's when we were Milan. And at that time, that's when we were very new. So Delilah, now then it goes to Delilah. So it was right after Moet Richards, it went to Delilah Milan. She won over Moet Richards. And then I think Moet retired because she was a mother. She got, you know, she got pregnant. So I think that was the thing that she no longer, I never saw her again. So basically, the girls that I mentioned were always voting against, you know, femme queens and butch queens and anyone, you know, even butches. You know, they were, whoever was voguing and bringing it, and they were all serving it, but they had a vogue with these women. So Delilah was kind of an awesome thing. You know, Delilah was doing her thing, and she was, you know, winning and serving it, and then we were judging myself and Delilah at the Milan ball, the alphabet ball, and we see this pretty little thing. Again, there was like now five girls. There was Mizrahi, there was Infinity, there were other girls from other houses. The girls started coming up now. You saw more women incorporating Vogue balls for Vogue than just two. And it was fabulous because you saw all these girls really pumping it and actually doing it the old way. And you saw this blonde girl, and she's flinging her head, and she's, you know, doing a straddle, and she's kicking it up, and she's getting very, very, very fish. And we're like, what the hell? That was Rihanna, who's that? And then Rihanna was like, I think that's not Rihanna, because we couldn't recognize her from the distance. Mind you, we clubbed with her. So we were like, what, mama? And we're like, okay. And, you know, we gave her, myself and Delilah gave her 10s, and the rest went to, I think, the House of Mizrahi girl. And the House of Mizrahi girl won, and it was over for both of them. I mean, the girls really served it. There were two women that were actually doing their thing and actually incorporating, and Mizrahi was giving you more old school, which was really good because it was a girl giving old way. Before they actually put the category all the way, you know, it was really nice. Wow. And Mariana was giving you sem. I mean, she was giving you really fishy girl. Yeah, it was fishy girl without looking like a butch queen voguing fan. She wasn't doing the 2015 European voguing. No. Word. She was giving you a girl that knew how to vogue, and just so happened she was extremely flexible, she was talented, and she was a dancer. So
you don't have to be a lesbian to be walking the category in the ballroom scene.
No, Amy wasn't a lesbian. And some of the girls I'm mentioning, I don't know if they are or not, but they weren't, you know, they weren't kissing girls, you know, they were
just wanted to get out there, you know, for the new
girls. No, it's the truth. Now, you didn't have to be they were straight girls. They were straight girls, they were gay girls. They were girls. They were women. If you bled once a month,
they used to call them.
No, if you bled, that's over for them. But it was like if you bled once a month, you could vote. That means you were a woman. That's how I saw. That was it. That was the key to. Now the side pack thing is that I saw that you, and I remember that you asked that question to Mariana. For me as a gay man, I remember what a fag hag back in the day was with me, and I understood that. It was a girl that she was so obsessed with homosexuals that she physically had some sexual relations with them, and she was like, I'm with a gay boy, he's my boyfriend, and the kiki, and that's what a fag hag was. Mariana Delilah weren't fag hags. They were girls that had boyfriends, fiercely, because they're lovely, and they were lovely, and they're still lovely. But they hung out with a lot of homosexuals. They had no problems with homosexuals. Just so happens they were club kids and they liked the gays. That's it. But they weren't, there was no title for them. They were girls.
There was no
intimacy. Yeah, it was just girls enjoying themselves. And just so happens, I think what happened with Delilah also, because I brought her into the Vogue deeply, and Mariana with the Infinities, is that you're club kids and you're cool with people and you're friends with them. They didn't have sex with us. So I don't, you know, they didn't want to be us. We didn't want to be them. We just loved them because they were our sisters. That's kind of how it was. They were our sisters and we adored them. And we're like, oh, mama, you want to vote? And they, you know, would drink something. And it was a, you know, old English 40. Well, back then it was, you know, it was a Cisco. So you would warm it up and then you would do your thing. And you would drink, you know, you would warm up the Cisco juice. And then I was kind of with the old English. And then you just party. It was really cool. Everything was very natural. Everything was very nice. And it was really sweet. It was extremely different. It was very different back then. Because remember, back then there was only beepers. So I would beep you to say that I was going to the house party. And then you would call me in my house. And we were there. And everything was fun. You know, now miscommunication. So, but you know about that.
All right. Have you ever been chopped from a ball?
Never. Never. I didn't have to win, but I never got chopped. There's no reason for it. You know why? Because you can see all of my videos on YouTube. And the way I vogue now, it was maybe 10 times more than because I had more energy. And I cared for more. Everything is voguing, 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 voguing. I didn't eat. I didn't care about nothing. I woke up in the morning and I went to school and I would go to dance class and stretch out voguing. I would do the fashion show voguing. I would go to art history and talk about where Vogue came from. So, yeah, voguing was my life. It was my life because it brought me out of a lot of dark situations in my life that were would have probably been depressing for me if I didn't have a house.
Or an outlet.
Yeah, an outlet. And voguing itself, which I consider it to be a passionate thing for me personally, has helped me because I was dealing with the AIDS crisis and the HIV with family members, crack, and all that stuff. My thing was like, I'm going to pop dip and spin. I'm going to vogue. I didn't have to deal with it. So I was never, that was not my part. My thing was very much, I'm voguing. I got to wake up tomorrow and go to school. Yeah, so...
How did you feel and how did you take that, you know, during this AIDS epidemic era?
What was interesting is that my school, actually, I remember, was the first school in New York City, New York State itself, to actually incorporate condoms in school. So when we went to human sexuality, they were throwing out condoms, and the teacher was explicit. He was on point. And I remember when I was leaving the class, he was like, you come over here. And he was like, Julian, I don't know if you're out, you're in, you're in between. I was like, he goes, but because of the fact that I don't know if you're out in between, I need you to be extra careful. Please use always a condom. Condoms always use. He was like, I don't care what you're doing and what situation you're going to be. And I wasn't offended because I liked the teacher before he stated that. Mind you, if it was a reverse, I would have read. Because I was already reading. I was already in the house, so I was already, oh, this thing, how dare you speak? No, when he said that, I was like, I thank you very much. And then another teacher looked at me when I came out. She was like, are you out now? But I was actually going into my senior year. And I was like, yes. She was like, I just need you to be careful. That's what I have to say. And I was like, what does she mean by that? Like, I don't want to be careful. I've been careful for 4 years. But I knew she meant by sex, and she didn't want to get, you know, you really can't talk about it, sex to a kid in high school. So she said, good, be careful. You know, the word be careful, I understood that from adults that have and did not have HIV, that would always use that word at the end of the sentence. It's just, you know, Julian, I love you very much. Be careful. And look at me. Yeah, so I would know that meant be careful sexually. So I was condoms 101. Yeah, that's how it was. And that's really how I have to say that, you know, when I speak to people, and I speak to people that are my elders and people of my generation that are HIV positive, I am not. You know, I am negative, and I'm very happy, and it's kind of unique. The reason that it's unique is because I was in that generation, so whatever the lookouts were doing with the boyfriend, I was doing too. You know, it's just the fact, and some of my friends were doing it with condoms, you know, so it wasn't the condom. I don't know what they were doing, what happened, but they don't really get into it, or they no longer will stay. Right. But I was always using a condom. My thing is always about safe sex, and You can be a lookout. You can be crazy. You can be promiscuous. You can do whatever you want to do. If you feel that you're comfortable with it, and then you feel that if someone is not going to shun you and you're not bothered, use a condom.
Do it right, right. Do it right.
Use a condom.
Play right.
Safe sex is fabulous. Well,
you would imagine, you know, being in the House of Magnifique with such strict rules. You know what I mean? You have
no. The House of Diva with strict rules. The House of Diva with strict rules.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
The House of Magnifique was fab. I mean, it was different. It was just a little fab. It was, yeah, because Frankie, the father of the House of, the first father of the House of Extravaganza, he incorporated and opened up another house. That was what happened, the House of Magnifique. And the House of Magnifique was incorporated by Frankie Extravaganza Magnifique. And it was a sister house. I was always in a sister house with the House of Extravaganza, because first was Magnifique, and when Magnifique closed down, it was Milan, and then Milan. So, and then Andy was my mother, and, you know, Hector was at that time, Hector was my grandfather. So Hector, when we first met, he was Amy's daughter. So that made him, I was his first grandson, and then I was incorporated to son, because he wanted me to stay, and he said it, I kind of pressured him. I was like, no, I'm over this grandson thing. We've been grandsons for over 20-something years. And I kind of was like, you know, father. And he was like, well, you're special because you're my first grandchild. and then now there's others, but you are my very first, and there's no other. And I was like, I like that. I would always throw that to somebody if they try it, but I want to be your son. So in 2004, he made me his gay son. Wow. Officially. But he was always my father.
Tell us a little bit more about the House of Magnifique.
The House of Magnifique was incredible. The House of Magnifique was all, it was a clubhouse, meaning the fact that we only incorporated our skills and talent in a club, but everyone recruited us. Like other houses come, you know, literally, I mean, we battled everybody. We were on television 24/7. We went to Europe. We did everything except go to a ball. We were not able to go to a ball. Frankie didn't want us to go do balls. I think that was probably the first house that didn't do balls. Back in the 80s. Yeah, he didn't want us to do balls. But I didn't know anything about a ball. Remember, I became a Milan. I did my first book as a Magnifique, and that was Pache, Milan. And then how I won was actually when I was in Milan. So it's kind of how it's funny how that kind of went. But Magnifique was phenomenal. I came out when I was a Magnifique. I was extremely known. You're so gay. And my brothers and sisters would look at me and they would kind of read. They were like, you know, so, no shame, Julian, but you feel a certain kind of way about gay people? And I'm like, what are you talking about? I love you. And they're like, no, you know, you give us kisses and you give us hugs, but you say you're straight. And I'm like, well, I'm straight. For years, I would say this. And I didn't, you know, you didn't get that when you were a kid. You're like, well, I'm straight. It doesn't mean that I'm embarrassed to be with you. But I didn't get, you know, I didn't get the two and two put together that if you're saying that you're not gay because you don't want people to think of a certain way about you, but then you only hang out with us and we're okay, you're still, you know, in some form you're just respecting us and you're kind of making, you're not supporting who we are as individuals. And everybody was out. Like everybody at 16, 17, they were proud. I was the only one saying, no, you're so straight. Yeah, so that kind of went very quickly. When I turned, I think at 19, my first, like, I kind of did the realization that I am gay, and I was with Delilah. We were at, like, a African Leisure float, and it was gay pride, and I just started crying, and I just started crying, and she goes, are you okay? And I was like, I'm okay, I was shaking, and she's like, but I was crying and happy. She's like, did you just come out? And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm like, what are you talking about? She goes, you just came out, didn't you? I was like, yeah, bitch, I'm gay. I'm happy. And for 3 months, hello, my name is Judy, I'm gay. Hello, my name is Judy, and I'm gay. I was just, and everyone was like, you don't have to tell us, Judy, you knew you were gay. I'm like, no, my name is Judy, and I'm gay. Yeah, I was happy. And I told everyone in high school, nobody, not one person, not my mother, my grandmother already knew, not my cousins, not any of my friends, not my ex-girlfriends. No one said anything, but we knew. We were just waiting for you to come out. And I was like, thank you. Not one. That was high school. Not one person. So I never got shunned in any form. So I was, again, a lot of things in my life have been very unique and very blessed by my people that, you know, protect me and guide me through what I have to go through in my path. They've always been with me. So I'm assuming they were there at the same time. So that's kind of how that goes with, you know, the House of Magnifique and how fabulous it was. But then, you know, the House of Magnifique closed and then we moved on. Everyone kind of went their direction.
All right. Who was your rivals when you were walking?
Oh, we didn't have rivals. You know what? Because I didn't walk more like Loca. I walked, you know, who I walked against, which was, you know, I walked against, but it wasn't rivals. It was, you know, because, you know, rivals, like, bring the bitch, I see you at the ball, I'm seeing you at the judges panel, and all this, and, you know, blah, 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 you know, that kind of, no, it was like, hi, Julian, how you doing? And it was, Eli Ebony was a good friend of mine. At first, we were like, I think I disrespected him. Like, what I did was that I battled him, and I pinned him at a club, and then he ran to me and was like, do you know who I am? And I was like, no, I don't know who you are. Like, I didn't know, I was a diva. I wasn't in the house yet. So he was like, I'm Eli Ebony, and you don't do this to a legend. And I was like, I said, I wasn't disrespecting you, but you were trying to pin me, and I pinned you, and I got up. Like, I didn't understand what I did wrong. You know, so when I realized that I pinned him, I was like, let me get up, because you don't have to be on somebody for 5 hours. You just pinned them, you get up. And then from that, I think he realized how I was speaking, that I had a clue of what was going on about really the etiquette and the rules of legends and newcomers, and I was a newcomer. Even though we were the same age, I was a newcomer. So we battled at another ball, and I got over him, and he gave me a hug, and we were friends. And I walked one ball against Andre Mizrahi back, and that was the Montana ball. You know, he got it over me. I got my chance. He got it over me. We hugged, and that was it.
Word.
You know, so, yeah, so everybody... You know,